Chinese communities are quite strong in this, and they deserve to be protected from humiliation based on their race. And I know that last year, a whole number of very anti-Semitic Facebook sites emerged. This hasn't been publicly reported before. And the Jewish Board of Deputies had absolutely no way of having them pulled down. Facebook flat out refused to pull them down. And it wasn't until they took it to the Human Rights Commission and invoked AT&C that they finally got this hugely offensive material pulled down. So I personally would err on the side of caution, and I think even though it'll impact on freedom of speech, it does more good than harm to keep the act as it is.
I think this is deeply concerning. Now, if you listen to George Brandis and accept that frame, you'd think this was the only restriction on freedom of speech in Australia. And of course, that's an nonsense. None of us can defame each other tonight. None of us can say something that's not true and outrageous. There's a restriction on freedom of speech. If you're in business, you can't engage in misleading conduct. As a member of parliament, I can't come in here tonight and say the speaker is biased. I'd be in contempt of the parliament. So, there are restrictions in a modern society on freedom of speech. And this is a very important protection. Why? Because we don't want society where it's okay to insult somebody because of their race. And this law has a history that wasn't introduced for fun. It was introduced as a result of a recommendation of the Royal Commission into racial violence, because racial vilification leads to racial violence. And we don't want to live in a society where that's regarded as okay. And this really just balances up the ledger that if you're a person who isn't very powerful and you're in a situation where you're vilified, this gives you a chance to have a say. Most cases don't even get to court. They get conciliated and they're sorted out in a room where a person says, you can't talk to me about that or about me like that. And we hear a lot about the Bolt case. Well, I don't want to have a situation in Australia where things like the Tobin case are acceptable, where somebody can say the Holocaust was made up as part of a Jewish conspiracy, and that's all right. It's not okay.
You're not putting Andrew Bolt's comments and Holocaust deniers the same.
But they've both been dealt with under this clause of the Act. That's the point I'm making. And that is not okay for that to be allowed to happen in Australia. People have a right to be respected and not to be insulted because of their race or nationality. And it's not just simply the person involved who has to take offence. A judge has to decide that a reasonable person take offence. It's quite a hard test, and judges have said that this would have to be a very serious thing that was said, not something trivial. And there are also protections in the Act for matters of art and scientific discussion.
Chris, I'm going to interrupt you because we've got a few people with their hands up. I'll just quickly go to that young lady down the corner.
For the Attorney General, as you just alluded to, there's Section 18D, which provides exceptions for legitimate political comment or legitimate artwork. Why do you think that 18C as it currently stands, with those exceptions in 18D, is insufficient?
Because Section 18C, as it's currently written, I understand the sentiment that the other panellists have expressed. But just realise what that means. What it means is that we are going to, if we don't appeal Section 18C in its current form, we're going to say in this country that political censorship is okay. Well, that's the necessary consequence of the argument that is being made against me. It's not the case that just because somebody says something outrageous or somebody says something that is offensive to community standards, that there should be a law against it, that they should be able to be dragged off to court or prosecuted or fined or even thrown in jail because they say something that community standards,
that is a variance from
community standards.
If I may finish, please.
The Bolt could have, as a matter of fact, if Bolt had repeated what he said, then he would have been in contempt of the federal.
Let's not categorize it as a criminal offence when you know that it is not.
But if you're missing the point, if Bolt had not abided by the order that was made against him, he would have been in contempt of court.
Okay, let's hear from Marcia Langton, who politely was letting you.
Well, this Bolt case is being put in now as if it were a matter of high politics. In my opinion, the arguments that Bolt wrote about several Aboriginal people were far from the subject of politics and simply abusive. Now, just had one instance. There was a young woman who was a victim of police abuse, and she is now a world-renowned immunologist, Dr. Misty Jenkins. Now, she's very fair-skinned, like my children, and I've known her since she was a young science student at the University of Melbourne. She later went on to do a PhD under Professor Peter Doherty. Then she went to Oxford and Cambridge, and she's worked hard all of her life. And she's a dedicated scientist, has never particularly benefited from her identity as an Aboriginal person. She has more than earned her way in life on the merits of her work. And yet she was a victim of foul abuse from Bolt, and she, as a result of that case, withdrew from public life. She used to speak to students. Now, nothing that he said about her was political. It was simply racial abuse. He argued that she had no right to claim that she was Aboriginal, and like most fools who put this argument in public, we are expected to deny our parents and our grandparents because somebody believes in race theories. So I absolutely refute that this has to do with political debate and suppression of political debate. This is about preventing victims of abuse from being racially abused. Now, he could say something about me that had nothing to do with my race, and that would not offend ALC. He could say all sorts of terrible things about me, and so long as they were not defamatory or in breach of ALC, that would be a legitimate debate, and I welcome him to do so. I'm perfectly capable of defending myself. But very often, people who are the victims of this kind of abuse are not capable of defending themselves.
Lieutenant George Brandis, if I understand you correctly, you are not in any way defending what Andrew Bolt said, is that correct? Did you find it offensive? I didn't agree with it. I don't agree at all with what Professor Langton said a moment ago. I think I know Andrew Bolt is not a racist. And to accuse Andrew Bolt is not a racist. And to accuse him of being a racist is itself a form of vile abuse of the man. He expressed an opinion. He expressed an opinion which you and some people in this audience tonight found offensive. Fair enough. I think he has the same right to express opinions that other people find offensive, as you have the right to express opinions that he might find offensive.
Just very briefly,
that's what a free society is.
If I could just get you to address what Marcia Lincoln specifically said about that the woman was withdrawn from public life because of the depth of the offence that she took from those comments. Are you sympathetic with people who are so deeply offended they withdraw from public life?
I don't know anything about the facts of that lady's particular case.
But aren't those sort of facts at the heart of the case?
No, I don't think they are. But the heart of the case, to my way of thinking, is this question, Tony. In a free country, should people have the right to say things that other people find insulting or offensive or wounding? And I think they should.
Do you think part of the reason why you can't sympathise or recognise...
I decided to sympathise.
You can't seem to understand how that would cause enormous discomfort to somebody and they would withdraw from public life. Do you think that's because you're a white, able-bodied, heterosexual
man? I don't think so at all. I think that you have to be very careful what you wish for here. Because
I think what people wish for is a civilised society.
They do. Of course they do. But how do we achieve a civilised society? Do we achieve a civilised society by having a civic culture in which those sort of offensive racist remarks or wrongful allegations of racism against other people, for that matter, are disapproved of by the society? Or do we have a society in which every time somebody says something unpopular or offensive to a majority of opinion, the Parliament passes a law to say, well, you are prohibited, you are censored from saying that?
Okay, I just want to go back to this side of the panel, and Terry Marks, and you were listening to this and you came out with a rather surprising personal view, which differs